Yeah, welcome to my workshop about GraphQL. Maybe some of you already heard about GraphQL, but didn't have any experience yet with it. So this I want to change today. Let's go through the agenda. First, I give a quick intro on to GraphQL and how it works, so everybody of us is on the same page. Then we will have a look at the basic API build with Rails and play a bit around with it to get to know GraphQL. Then we should be ready to do some exercises against the real GraphQL API. We take the one from GitHub. And at the end of my blog, I give a quick outlook on how to use GraphQL in the front end, with the help of Apollo Client, the front-end library. The goals of my blog are that you know about GraphQL and how you can use it, and that you also gather some experience with it, how to write queries, and how it works, and that you know about the benefits of using Apollo Client in the front-end. So let's start with the introduction. What is GraphQL? Here's a quote from the GraphQL page. You can read it. So quite some promising words there. So now look what's behind these words. First, I want to show you a really basic example of a GraphQL request. So first thing you notice is that there will only be one endpoint, and it's normally called /GraphQL. And you send all your queries there. And how does a query look like? We have here a basic query. Here we query the user with the ID 1, and of that user we want the name of it. Again the name, but this time with the key username and the created ID. And the response looks exactly like we specified it in the request. Yeah, like this. So what are the benefits of using GraphQL? In the front-end, as we saw, you can really shape the response and in the front-end, so you can ask exactly for the data you need. Like this, you can get many resources in only one request and no unnecessary data is loaded, so only the data you really need. This is especially great for mobile, where you have high latency and not that good internet connectivity every time. In the backend, you can have a versionless API because the client asks exactly for what he wants, so you can give him always what he wants. What he wants, yes. Of course, you can introduce breaking changes and stuff like that, but the possibility to have a versionless API is much more simpler with GraphQL. You can combine multiple backends into a single GraphQL endpoint. I will come back on this point later. And you don't need any API documentation because this is generated out of the schema automatically, and it's a really cool feature. We will experience it later in the exercises. One thing to say about GraphQL is that it's strongly typed. To explain this, we take a look at the basic GraphQL schema. The schema is, it describes what the API is capable of doing. So everything there, you can query for in the API and nothing more. So if you look here, we start at the bottom. We have defined here the schema and with a field query of type query. The type query is specified here. It has two fields, get alpha, which takes a param ID of type integer and returns alpha. say with getPosts by title, takes a param string and returns an array of posts. Posts and alpha are described above, so I think you get the point. It's quite similar to TypeScript, where you have the typing, yes?
So DSL is always the same format, this schema. It's defined by GraphQL, it's now...
This is the DSL of GraphQL, so this is specified, but yet you have different implementations, and there it's, yeah, we will see it later. There it varies a bit, but it boils down to this every time.
Take it other application instead of root just like.
Yeah, you maybe need to change a bit the syntax of it, because you don't have the same syntax on every platform. So you can't use you. Yeah, this is quite general. Yeah, we will see it later. One special note about this, there are three root types. The one we saw here is query. Then there is, you need query to, yes, you can think about it like a GET request in the REST. There are mutations to alter some data and change it, like a POST request in REST. And also subscriptions to subscribe on a field that's like the WebSocket connections, where you get real-time updates. One thing to notice is that subscription is not yet fully supported in all implementations. So I guess for GraphQL Ruby, the keyword is accepted, but it's not really implemented in the gem. For Elixir, I know it supports it already. But we don't want to dive deeper into subscription in this workshop. Let's look again on some example queries. We query here for the subscribers with the publication Apollo Stack. And from this, we want the name and email. So a response then looks like this. We get an array with name and email of the results. Another query against the schema we saw before, for example, is the get alpha with ID5. Of this alpha, I want the name and the posts. Of this post, I want title and the alpha. From the alpha, I want the name. And yes, the name will be the same as this one, because it's alpha and yeah, should make sense. How does GraphQL execute the request? So there are three execution steps involved. First is parsing. It's like JSON parse, where you catches any syntax error. Then the second one is a very interesting one, the validation. So what it does, it checks the input arguments, if they are of correct type, if the name is correct, and it checks if the fields you query are really in the type and are valid. So like this, GraphQL takes you the work which you had to do for REST API to check all the input params and sanitize them. So this does GraphQL for you now. And the third step is finally the execution, where it executes the query from top down. Then there is the concept of resolvers. So every field has its own resolver function. What does that mean? For this, we look at the basic Ruby implementation of a user type. You define it like this. We have a field ID of type int and a field email of type string. For those, we don't provide a resolve function, so they get mapped automatically to the object field. But for the updated that and the created that, we do provide a resolve function which returns type int. And the resolve function looks like this. We convert the created that to an integer. And like this, you basically can change data for every field. You could put some authorization logic here in place to look if the user is authorized to see this field.
Is it all by yourself or is it by the new generate?
The author. Yeah, normally, also if you just do it like that, it's automatically just object ID and email. So often you do it just like that. But if you have special types or you need to do something special in a field, then you can provide a resolve function. I don't know how it's implemented there. Another example of resolvers can look like this. This is again in Ruby. We have the mutation type where we have four fields like create user, and here we provide a create user resolver like this. You can do it like as you know it before with the rest. So if you have a controller call like create, then you delegate it like to a service to create something, and yeah, you can separate it really nicely like that. The powerful thing about this, you can do anything in a resolve function. This means also you can fetch data from different locations. So imagine we get the author from the SQL query, so we have stored in a database, but the post of an author, we request it from another API, and this works. So you really can combine multiple backends into one single self-documented GraphQL endpoint. So this is also a really cool feature. Because I think let's take a deeper look into queries so you are ready for the exercises later. On the left side, these are called fields. You can pass them in some arguments like that. Of course the arguments have to be specified in the schema, otherwise it's frozen error. You can provide variables. It's quite easy. You have the query. You need to specify the operation type. So now query would be also mutation, for example. You can provide an operation name. This is optional. And then you have your variables. It starts with a dollar sign and then the name of it, followed by the type of it. And then you can use it in the query like this, again with the dollar sign. Again, another look on the structure of it. So here we see we do a query, so we query the field query. And from the query type, we select the hero field, which returns a hero. And from this hero, we want the name of it. So this is how you can think about it. Now think if you have a really big query, for example, and in there you have two places where you specify some fields of a user, for example, first name and last name, and you have that two times in your query, then you can extract it to a fragment. And the syntax is like this. You specify a fragment, the name of the fragment, and on which type it should be applied on. So GraphQL knows which fields you have access to or that you can query for. How is this used? If we query for a hero in an episode, and on the hero field we want the name and also the comparison fields from the fragment earlier. So from hero is of type character. Okay. And if it's a droid, this is an inline fragment. We want to create also for primary function, but only if it's on droid. So this type check is really helpful. For example, if you have a search field, which returns multiple types because it's a search, and then you can specify on which type you want which fields. And we go a bit crazier with directives. Like this, you can skip or include parts of your query based on expression. It doesn't make much sense here, but it's just here to show what's possible with directives. So, enough of theory. Let's get our hands on GraphQL. But there's one more thing. we do some exercise with GraphQL, so you play a lot with it. It's a tool included in almost all GraphQL libraries, and it's really handy to make API test calls and browse the documentation of it. How does the user interface look like? It's like this. I begin on the top right, so you will have a button here which says docs. If you click on it, this pops out, and in here there you will have two fields, first query and mutation, and then you can start browsing it, because all of this function and types and things like that are clickable, so you can really browse deeper in your documentation. And yeah, it's a really cool feature, you will see. And I guess you don't want to miss it anymore. On the left side here, we specify our query we want to do against the API. Here I just inserted the example which makes use of most things I said earlier. So we have here the variables. You can input them in this field below. You need to click on here query variables to pop this up, otherwise it's hidden. And then you can provide here a key value object, and this gets inserted in the variables here. And we have inline fragments and a fragment which you can specify like this. And here we convert the login to a nickname variable. So here's the response field. Here we see nickname instead of login name. So this is just to show you.
Is it necessary on my specific?
Yes, I think so. You will see if you start typing in this field, it offers you auto completion. And if you type something wrong, it marks it as wrong. And yeah, if you execute then the query, it just returns here an error. And also the error messages are mostly quite helpful. So we will see later. So what we do? For the first part, there is a really cool sample project on GitHub. There is an installation guide on it. It's really simple, basic Rails app, and how you get started. And there are also some example queries where you can start off, and you can have also a look at the code. It's interesting, and play around with it, do whatever you like. I'm here to answer questions. So I think for the next about 20 minutes, you have time to dig in this project. The link to the presentation is in the Learning Week channel, so you can get to this. Okay, fun. Everybody, I think now you are ready for a real GraphQL API, and if you don't feel like that, you can still play around with the local one. For the next exercise, we now try to query the GraphQL API from GitHub. And for this to work, because we need to edit the headers and the one the GraphQL we had, you can't do that. So you need to install the standalone app like this. You can go through the installation later. And yeah, you start it. It's pretty basic. You need to create a GitHub authorization token. For this, you can click on this link. There should be everything pre-selected already. So just generate the token and copy it, because you can see it later. You can see it only once. And then in the headers, yeah, put the authorization header name with the token like this, prepended with zero, and this important the space between. Yeah, if you have done this, I think you'd then be ready to query the GraphQL API. But before you start, let me take a quick spoiler. So in their API, you will see a lot of connections, edges, and nodes. This comes from the relay specification. Relay is the front-end GraphQL client which Facebook uses, so there is a really strict specification on that. And it's used especially for cursor-based pagination, but that's quite a complex matter, so this would easily fill another blog. So that's why I just provided two links for those who are eager to learn more about that. But I won't dive in deeper into it. I think you can get easily around it if you just, yeah, no, yeah, edges. There's just the nesting deeper. Yeah. It's from Facebook, but GitHub implements also the relay specification, so you can use it also with relay.
It's a library.
Yeah, there are two major GraphQL frontend library, Relay, which is really opinionated on the specification, and Apollo client, which we will show you later. Okay. I prepared some exercises. Just to give you an input. I would say you start with the first two queries and then try the mutation. So you already did the mutation, and then you can continue with the other exercises, because probably you won't make it, or if you do, that's better. I think.
Please don't make all annual repositories.
Yes. Yeah, that's because I provided just one mutation and a really simple one with reaction, so we shouldn't break that much. So be careful with mutations.
Maybe it's worth saying also to delete the key generator.
Yeah, I hope I remember to keep you reminding that. To get to the solution, there are different ways. So you can come from, for example, repository. You can come from your side. Yeah, there is no really this solution. So yeah, you just experiment with it and try to come to this data. I ask it in these exercises. If something is not really clear, ask me. I try the best to describe them. Yeah, then you can go through the installation guide for the GitHub thing and start with these exercises. Yeah, I hope you had some success moments with all these queries and could also see the potential of all of the GraphQL thingy. Now, I want to give you a quick outlook on the front-end side, how we can use GraphQL there, together with the Apollo GraphQL client. It's a really cool library, and I wanted to show you some features of it. First, what exactly is Apollo? So it's a really flexible, community-driven, and therefore open-source GraphQL client for React, JavaScript, and almost all kinds of platforms. And why should you use it? Well, yeah, it says write queries, not code. Yes, you still have to write some code there, but it simplifies a lot regarding all the network request stuff, caching stuff, and yeah, it takes really a burden off of you. Yeah, some features. I just put in the picture from the website from them. Maybe you can just quickly look over it. Sounds quite promising, especially that it supports a lot of platforms. Like, I think the most you will use ever. let's see how we can use it in the front end. So I made a very basic component. I did the example in Angular because I guess most of you know it. Yeah, from the frameworks it supports. So we have here a simple component. Nothing special there. What is special is maybe that we have on top of it, we define our query. So here we can specify the data we need in the component, like this. And afterwards in the component, we just call this Apollo watch query and pass in this query, and it takes care of the rest. And as soon as the data arrives, we assign it to this data, which in the template it returns the observable. So that's also quite nice a feature. So you can use the async pipe to unwrap it right in the template. So that's all you need to do to display the data for scores, for example. Quite simple, right? How does the mutation part look like? It's quite the same. You again describe your mutation here. This time we use variables, because it's a mutation, we have to pass in some values. And down here we just call mutate, pass in the mutation and the variable's values. And then we can subscribe on it, and if it succeeds, or print out error message if it fails. That's the mutation part. Really nice. I want to mention some more really cool features of it, more on the technical part. So of course, which we saw, it handles all the data fetching and also the caching. So the cache is also quite interesting. If you make a query, as we saw before, you make a call to watch query. So what this means, if you make in one component a query, for example, person first name, then it makes a request to the server, receives the first name. if you make in another component, maybe some seconds later, you make another query. And in this one, maybe somewhere deeply nested, you get the same person, also first name, maybe also the last name. And it makes this query then. And if the response contains another first name for that person, it updates also the first one. So you have really consistent user interface like that. It does this by normalizing all the data it receives. So you have a really flat list with objects like that. That's quite the magic behind that. it provides you optimistic response feature. You can use this if you have a really basic mutation where you know how the response probably will look like. Then you can provide Apollo the response, which you think, you can provide any value there, but you can provide the values you think the response will have. And this way, it can update the store, so the user interface already, when it even just made the request. And it takes care of this optimistic response you provided and treats it a bit separate. And as soon as the response arrives from the server, it discards the optimistic response and replaces it by the real response. So this makes the UI really make feel responsive without the waiting time for the server. It batches, you can batch queries with it. So a common thing you have with, for example, an Angular app is if you load the initial app or something, multiple components gets loaded at once. And every component has some query specified in there. And there would be a lot of queries on the first, a lot of requests, especially on the, if you load the web app the first time. With batching, Apollo takes all the queries and takes it into one request, makes one request to the API, and yet it remaps the response then again. So you only have one request for all these queries then. For this, the server has to support it, but I think for GraphQL Ruby, it's not that complicated to enable this. A bit like this, it deduplicates queries by default. So if a query is in flight, a query request is in flight to the server, and another one, and you make another one on the client side, which is the same, it doesn't make a second request, but waits till the response comes in and then resolves both client-side requests. So you only have one request and don't do two requests, which would be the same. It's extremely customizable, for especially with Apollo Links, which got introduced in Apollo 2.0. With it, you can specify all the networking stuff. You can say, this query type I want to send to a REST API. This type I want to send to the GraphQL API. GraphQL subscription types I want to send to my WebSocket endpoint and stuff like that. I just recently, AWS announced AppSync, their conference. And it's also built on top of with Apollo, and they replaced the real-time network interface, so they don't use WebSocket for it, but another protocol like I think MQTT. I'm not sure, but I think it really shows off the customizability of Apollo. Because it's community-driven and open-source, there are some nice helper tools like Chrome DevTools integration and even a TypeScript type annotation generator, which generates TypeScript annotations out of your GraphQL queries and schema. It has really good docs with some receipts for some, for example, authorization, how you do pagination and stuff like that. And it's open source, and a lot more. And I think it's really worth a try. I think you can build really cool front-end apps with it. That was my outlook on Apollo client. I hope you liked it. And
thank you very much.
Apollo.
Yeah.
Yes.
Did you?
What I used was I made a simple chat application with React, and I used optimistic response and also subscription, so GraphQL subscription. I used it together with Elixir GraphQL backend. And it was first you still have to write a bit complicated code to, if you make a mutation, and for example then you, if you get the response, you need to update the store by yourself at the time. And there you, it gets a bit complicated because you have to check if it's, if you have subscription on the other side running, you need to check, is it already in the store because of the subscription, or do you need, do you have to add it?
I wanted to ask whether all this is a smart caching functionality really, or doesn't in the end or effects we have pulling to, for example, caching somehow leads to very nasty.
Yeah. With the cache, not that, no. Didn't play around with that that much. Yeah, that's always a bit the downside of a cache, but it has also its pros. Yeah, but they on the version 1 they used Redux internally, and with version 2.0 they got rid of it, Redux. So you can provide anything you want. You can customize the store which it uses for the cache. Yeah, you have almost full control over that. So.